As discussed in the previous class, we are going to start with functions. We are going to start with functions because I personally believe, and I believe this with conviction, that without knowing functions, it's very difficult to understand the subsequent part of our class 12th topics, because everything is based on functions. Now, the topic name is actually relations and functions. But relations part, I have already done, complete extent in class 11th. Okay, so in relations, you have types of relations. So if you check your notes of class 11th, I had already discussed about void relation, universal relation, reflexive relation, symmetric relation, transitive relation, equivalence relation, and we have done enough questions on that as well. Okay, so today I'm going to start with functions. So let me just give you an overview of the functions chapter. In functions, the prerequisite for this is your class 11th domain and range. So the prerequisite is your concepts of domain and range. I hope everybody who is sitting over here is fine with the idea of domain and range. Now in class 12th, of course, domain and range will be useful. More importantly, range will be useful, right? Because later on, we are going to talk about something called onto functions, where you will be asked to find out the range of the function. Don't worry, if you are a new joiner, you are not with us in class 11th, we will talk about finding the range as and when we reach this topic. So these are the two prerequisites for you from class 11th. So this you must have done in class 11th. Okay. So 11th concepts. Okay. So what are we going to study in 12th? So in 12th, we are going to first talk about number one, types of functions. Types of functions. This is very important because it will be tested in your board exam as well, if at all it happens. No, I think it will happen. Something will happen in your time, don't worry. Yeah, types of functions. Then we'll be talking about composition of functions. Composition of functions. Followed by inverse of a function. Okay. Now, composition of function is very, very important for your competitive level exam point of view, but not very important from your school point of view. So from your school point of view, type of functions, inverse of a function, these are the two main concepts that will be tested. Weren't we supposed to start for conics? No, I told you I'll be starting with functions, and after I complete functions, we'll be starting with the part of the conic, because conic will not take at least 1 month. So we are waiting for a right time to begin. Okay, so don't worry about it. Next concept that we are going to take in functions is periodic functions. Periodic functions. This part again is not for your school. Periodic function is not included under your school syllabus. Okay. Next, we are going to talk about the concept of even odd functions. Even odd functions. Though we know it, officially we have not done it, so we are going to do it. So we are already aware of even function and odd function. We have been talking about it since our bridge course days. But officially, we have not done this concept. We are going to take this up officially in class 12th. Okay. And finally, we are going to talk about functional equation. We are going to talk about functional equations. Okay. Now, functional equations also, let me tell you, when you are solving questions in your DPPs, you would have definitely come across something like, if f of x plus f of y is f of xy, find so and so, right? So what is this? This is actually a type of a functional equation. Okay. So we'll be dealing with problems based on functional equation as well. People who are prepared for RMOs, pre-RMOs or INMOs, they would have already done it during their preparation because this is a very integral part of Olympiads. Okay. Never mind, even if you have not attempted these exams before, you will be taught this concept from scratch. Don't worry much about it. Okay, so these are the concepts that we are going to cover under this. And yes, after this, we are going to definitely start with conics. So for the new joiners, let me tell you, we have done conics only till board level concept or for your class 11. We haven't done it from your JEE main point of view. So we'll be taking that up as well. All right, so let us begin with types of functions. Types of functions. Before that, just a quick recap of functions. Not to the extent that I'll be teaching you how to find domain and range. What is a function, first of all? Most of you already know it, so I would like to hear from you. What type of relations are basically called functions? Yes, it's a mathematical machine for sure, but formally speaking, how do you define a function? So what type of relations qualify to be called a function? Exactly. So functions, when you say functions, okay, so those relations qualify to be called functions if they satisfy the fact that every pre-image has a unique image. Okay, so in this kind of a mapping, you would realize that every element of set A must be used. Okay, I'll just give you a simple example for the same. Let's say I have a relation from set A to set B. Okay, where relation A has, let's say, A1, A2, A3, A4, and the set B has B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. Okay, so let me ask you a simple question. If I make a mapping like this, let's say A1 goes to B1, A2 goes to B3, A3 goes to B2. Is this mapping a function or is this relation a function? The answer is no, right? Because A4 is left out. That is why this word every is very important. Every pre-image. Now, pre-image and image, I hope everybody is clear. So when there's a mapping like this, that means A1 comma B1 is a part of that relation. So A1 is called the pre-image of B1. And B1 is called the image of A1. Okay, I hope the name pre-image and image is clear to everybody. So this doesn't qualify to be a function. So this is not a function because A4 is left out. Okay, now let us say A4 maps to B4. Okay, is this a function? Is this a function? The answer is yes, because every pre-image, first of all, is undergoing a mapping, and every pre-image has a unique image, right? So there is no element from set A which is mapping to multiple elements of set B. Okay, now even if, let's say, A4 goes and maps to, let's say I undo this, even let's say A4 goes and maps to B2, it is still a function because A4 has a unique image of B2. A3 also has a unique image of B2, right? But something like this, let me again undo this. Something like this, where let's say A4 goes to B4 and A4 also goes to B5. This is not a function because this uniqueness criteria, the unique image criteria, is being not fulfilled by this relation. Okay, so I hope everybody is clear about the basic definition of what makes a relation a function. Every pre-image, the word every, has a unique image, the word unique. So these two words are very important, every and unique. Okay, so in this case, this is not a function. So I'll just undo this part. Okay, so this is an example of a, so this relation can be called as a function. This relation can be called as a function. Okay, now a simple question I would like to ask you. Let us say there is a, let's say there is a function from set A to set B, where A has got n number of elements, B has got r number of elements. Okay? Okay. First tell me, okay, let's not call it function as of now. Let's call it as relation only. Tell me how many relations are possible from set A to set B. Everybody should respond. How many relations are possible from set A to set B? How many relations, Gayatri? Okay, Havish has given. Shitesh has given. Okay, Ritvik. Awesome. Vabhav. Everybody is giving different answers. Okay, Bhumika. So as of now, I can see just two of you giving the right answer. Just two of you. And almost, I think, 12, 15 people have responded. Okay, Nishant. Gaurav says there cannot be any relation at all. Okay. Okay, Anusha, Advik. Very good. So now let us understand this. Number of relations are nothing but, what is a relation? Relation is a subset of the Cartesian product of A and B. Correct? Now recall your class 11th days when you were learning sets. So the number of subsets of a particular set. Okay, so let's say there is a set X. Okay, just a quick recall. Okay, I'll just write a recall over here. So let's say there is a set X which has got X number of elements. Okay. So how many subsets are possible of this set X? The answer used to be 2 to the power X. Oh, sorry, 2 to the power small x, not capital X. Or 2 to the power number of elements in the given set X, isn't it? Now, from where does this result come? You're already aware of it. So to make a subset, you either need no element. Okay, so you can say X is 0 or 1 element or 2 element. Or you could take all the elements. So as per your sum of the binomial coefficients you have learned, it is 2 to the power of x. Okay, so that's how this result actually comes. Anyways, so now relating this fact to the present question here, which asks you, how many relations are possible from set A to set B? Now, A cross B, the number of elements in this set, we all know is the product of the number of elements in A into number of elements in B. So as per our given scenario, it is N into R, correct? So if I ask you how many relations are possible, as per this formula, relation is a subset of A cross B. So your number of relations possible will be 2 to the power N R. Okay, so this result must not be forgotten because you may get a direct question asking you for the number of relations. Even in class 12th, it can happen. Okay, so normally this question is asked in class 11th, but it may also come in class 12th as well. So number of relations is 2 to the power nr. So people who are saying different responses, nr is basically true for the number of elements in A cross B, not the number of relations from A to B. So please be careful about it. Okay. Okay. Now, extending this question, how many functions are possible from A to B? So let's say there's a function from A to B. Again, the same situation holds. There are n elements in A and there are r elements in B. How many functions are possible? How many functions are possible from A to B? Yes. What's your response? What's your response? Okay, Adit. Okay. Shitij, Aditya, Anusha. Okay. Okay. What is that? R P own means? Oh, R to the power. Okay. 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 Good. Okay. Now, if I am a person, if I'm a layman and I have to derive this result, it's very easy to derive. So let us say this is my set A, which has got N number of elements, and this is my set B, which has got R number of elements. So let's say I call this as A1, A2, A3 till let's say A n. And this set B has B1, B2, B3 till BR. Okay. Now, in order to count how many functions are possible from A to B, let us look at how many choices of mapping does each of the element of set A have. So how many choices does A1 have? If you see, A1 can map to any one of B1, B2, B3 till BR. So this has got R choices. Correct? How many options A2 has? A2 again will have R choices. Now why? Because let's say if A1 goes and maps to B2, then you cannot stop A2 also from mapping to B2. A2 also can go and map to B2. Right? Please note, this is not the unique criteria. The uniqueness criteria says one element of set A cannot have multiple images. Two elements can have the same image. That is fine. But one element of set A or one pre-image cannot have multiple images. Right? So which is not happening in this case? A1 has got only one image, B2. A2 has only got one image, again B2. Are you getting my point? So many people say R-1, or many people give different responses. But the answer here is A2 also has R options. A3 will also have R options. Correct? So like that, all these n elements will have R each. So as per fundamental principle of multiplication, why I'm using fundamental principle of multiplication? Because my task will not be completed till all the elements of set A are getting mapped. Are you getting my point? So A1 has to get mapped, A2 has to get mapped, A3 has to get mapped, An, till An has to get mapped. Till all of them get mapped, your mapping or your functions will not be created, because I cannot leave out any one of your A1, A2, A3. Are you getting my point? Okay. Now, some people are saying NCR, Pranav. Why NCR? What if N was less than R? What will you do? Then you'll say there is no function possible. Okay. All right. You corrected yourself. No worries. So number of functions possible will be R into R into R, N number of times. So your answer will become R to the power N. So this is your final verdict, R to the power N, not to be forgotten, because you will not get time to derive all these things in your examination hall. Okay. So here is a verdict. If you have any function from A to B, then the number of functions, I will just generalize it, the number of functions will always be, number of elements, or let's say the number of elements in the codomain raised to the power of number of elements in the domain. Okay, so very easy to remember. Codomain to the power domain, codomain to the power domain, codomain to the power domain. So number of elements in codomain here is R, number of elements in the domain is N, R to the power N. I hope everybody knows what's a codomain, what's a domain, what's a range. Okay, everybody's clear with that. Anybody who has an element of doubt about what is domain, codomain, and range, do let me know. I'll be most happy to explain you again. Everybody's fine? Pakka, sure? Okay, good. Everybody is clear. Good. All right. So with this quick recap, I'm ready to start with types of functions. So let us start with types of functions. So the first type that we are going to look at is called one-one function. Okay, one-one function. It is also given an alternate name called injective functions. Injective functions. Many a times, inject word and ion word is combined to make it injections. Okay. Okay. So injective plus ion functions, there is a combination of this word, and they're called injections also. Okay. But mostly you will hear one-one and injective functions in your books also. Now, what is an injective function? Any function where every image has a unique pre-image. Okay. So in those functions where every image has a unique pre-image. Now, what is image? Image are basically members of the range. Getting my point? So whatever mapping is happening with the elements of set B, those elements will be comprising the range, right? So if whatever elements are getting mapped in B, it should have a unique pre-image. Now recall from our definition of functions, multiple pre-images could go to the same image, right? So functions basically can have a possibility that multiple elements of set A can map to a single element of set B. That is possible, right? But one-one functions are those functions where this mapping is such that the element of B which is getting mapped has a unique pre-image rather than having a multiple pre-image. So a typical example I can show you, or a typical arrow diagram I can show you. So this is an example of a one-one function mapping. So let's say there is a set A to B and there is a function which is 1-1. So this mapping will look like this. Okay, so let's say A1 maps to B2, A2 maps to B3, and A3 maps to B1. Okay, so as you can see that every image, so B1, B2, B3, okay, they are all images of some pre-image, right? So there is a unique pre-image for B1, which is only A3. There is a unique pre-image for B2, which is only A1. There is a unique pre-image for B3, which is only A2. Okay, so these kind of functions are called one-one functions or injective functions. Yes, Himanshu, very good point brought. Himanshu is saying, sir, you said every, but B4 is left out. Himanshu, tell me, is B4 any image? Is B4 an image? If yes, what is its pre-image? Is B4 qualified to be called an image? Then why are you asking? Anusha, I hope your concern is addressed. Every image, B4 is not an image. Image kisko kehte hain? Image is basically elements of your range. Is B4 a part of your range? No, right? So then why is the question arising? So whatever is a part of your range, those are called images, correct? So they should have a pre-image, because unless a pre-image is there, there cannot be an image, correct? It's like there has to be an object, then only its image will be cast, right? Image cannot be cast without an object. So the pre-image is like the object. So if B4 is an image, then worry about this definition. B4 is not an image. Okay. Is this fine? Any questions here? Now, basically, examples of these functions are seen, in our daily, solving of problems. So I can give you some examples. Let's say I take a simple linear function or linear polynomial 2x plus 3. Okay, this is a 1-1 function. This is a 1-1 function because if you have any output coming from it, it will come only from one particular input. For example, if I compare this to 10, I can only have one x for that 10, and that is 7/2. There is no other x for which I will get a 10. That is what it says. Every image has a unique pre-image. Okay, so there cannot be two values of x for which I will get a 10. Or for that matter, any number you take, from the image, you will find that is coming from a unique pre-image. It cannot come from multiple pre-images. Is it clear? Let me give you another example which will shock you. X square. Now you must be thinking, x square, how can it be a 1-1 function? Because if I want a 9, it can come from 3 also, and it can come from -3 also. But please note, what have I written for the domain of the function? right? I have written R plus. That means if I want a 9, it will come only from 3. Minus 3 is not a part of your domain. Now, what message I want to give through this example is, whenever you are trying to decide whether a function is 1, 1 or not, please take its domain into consideration. Don't start judging the function by only its definition. Because when I ask this question, 99% of the people's first response is, sir, it doesn't seem to be a 1, 1 function. Why? Because they just judge it on the basis of its definition. No, you have to also take into account what is the permissible domain. Are you getting my point? So under this restriction, if you see x square function, x square will only have this kind of a graph. Okay, so if I want a 9, it can come only from 3. That means 9 as an image can have only one unique or a unique pre-image, which is 3, nothing else. Okay, so I can cite multiple examples of 1, 1 function. However, the opposite of 1, 1 or complementary of 1, 1 is many 1, which I will talk in some time. I'm not going to discuss about it in detail, but just wanted to give you a heads up that what is not 1, 1 is actually called a many 1. Okay, so had I included R over here instead of R plus, then X square would have become a many 1 function. Okay, many 1 separately, I will talk about it. So let us talk in detail about 1, 1, because this is going to be a very important part for us. Okay. Any question related to the definition of a 1, 1 function? No, it doesn't include R plus. It doesn't include R plus. Sorry, it doesn't include 0. R plus doesn't include 0. Yes, everybody's fine with what is a 1, 1 function? Any question, any concerns? Himanshu, Anusha, Pranav, Gaurav, Shitej, Aditya, Pratik, Bhumika, everybody is fine. Everybody is happy. Clear, 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 clear. Okay, very good. Chalo, now if it is clear, I have a question and please address my doubt, my question. How many 1, 1 functions are possible? Okay, so I'm introducing a permutation combination idea within functions. Okay, so how many 1, 1 functions are possible? Number of 1, 1 functions. So let's say I have a function defined from set A to set B. Again, let's say A has n number of elements, B has got R number of elements. Okay, who will tell me what is the number of 1, 1 functions possible from set A to set B? What is the number of 1, 1 functions possible from set A to set B? Think carefully and then answer. Do not be in a rush. Give your answer in a well thought upon manner, because I'm going to cross question you also. Aram se, take your time. Okay, so two people have already answered. Okay, Nishant, that's a very unique answer from you. Do you mean to say R factorial? Nishant? Okay, Gaurav, Bhumika. So Nishant, you wrote R, R minus 1, R minus 2, dot, dot, dot. So I think you'll go to 1, right? So that becomes R factorial. Isn't it, Nishant? Okay, okay. Aditya is saying it will change depending upon the situation. Okay, Aditya, very good. Thankfully, you took that into account, because everybody is giving a very flat answer for it. Okay, so Aditya is actually correct. Now let's try to analyze the situation. Okay, I'll take one first situation where, let's say, number of elements in the codomain is less than the number of elements in the domain. Okay, then how many 1, 1 functions are possible? Let's try to take a situation, a very small situation. So let's take a case study where R is less than n. Okay, I will assume that R is 3 and let's say n is 5. That means the number of elements in the codomain is 3 and the number of elements in the domain is 5. Let's call it as A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5. Okay. Now, let's start the mapping. Let's say I'm trying my best to generate a 1-1 function. Okay, I'll try my best to generate or create or produce a 1-1 function. So let's say A1 maps to B1. Okay. Now, A2 could have mapped to B1, but as I told you, I'm trying my best to create a 1-1 function out of it. So A2 will go to B2 or B3 for that matter. Now, A3 could go to B1, B2, B3, anything. But again, as I told you, I am trying my best to generate a 1-1 function. So I'll map it to B3. But what will I do with A4 and A5? I don't think so there's an option left for A4 other than mapping to one of B1, B2, B3. Correct? So if I go and map to any one of them, then gone. It doesn't remain a 1-1 function. So it actually becomes a many-1 function. And no matter how hard you try, you will not be able to generate one. So what is the verdict here? What is the conclusion that we can draw? That if R is less than N, you cannot get any 1-1 function. So number of 1-1 functions is 0. Correct, Gaurav. Gaurav, now you have corrected yourself. Anusha, sir, I think it depends on what you consider as the range. Anusha, does that point get clarified over here or still any element of doubt? Anusha Venkat? Clear? In this case, at least it is clear. Okay, at least your doubt is clear in this case. Okay, now let's talk about the next situation where your R is equal to N. Where your R is equal to N. So let's take a case study of this as well. So next case study where I'll take R is equal to N. Let's say both are 3-3. Okay. So again, let me draw an arrow diagram. A has got A1, A2, A3. B has got B1, B2, B3. Again, I'll be trying my best to generate a 1-1 function. So A1 can map to, let's say, any one of them, B1. So A1 has got actually 3 options. Okay. It can map to B1 or B2 or B3. So if you talk about options available for A1, 3 options are available. How many options are available for A2? Now, if you try to make a 1-1 function, A2 cannot map to B1 then. Correct? So A2 can map either to B2 or B3. So it has got 2 options now. So A2 will have 2 options and let's say it chooses B3 as its mapping partner. Then A3 will be left with no choice but to go to B2. So this guy will have only one option or one choice. Now this was only for a very small case where I considered only 3 elements in A and B. If you scale this up to, let's say, R elements in each or N elements in each, what do you think should be the answer? In this case, your answer was 3 into 2 into 1, which is 3 factorial. And if you scale this up to R elements, your answer will become R factorial or, yes, RPR, whatever you want to call it. Fancy names of calling the same thing. So R factorial or N factorial or RPR, RPR or NPN. All of them mean the same thing. So let me include that as well. So you'll be, okay. So you have NPN also included. Okay. So any one of them basically all mean the same thing. R factorial, N factorial, RPR, NPN, because R is equal to N. Fine. Now, let us take the last case, which is the only case left off for us. What happens when R is more than, let me write it in yellow. When R is more than N. And again, let us consider a case study on that. So if R is more than N, for the purpose of making our life simpler, we'll take this 5 and we'll take this as 3. Okay. So let me make an arrow diagram. So 3 elements in set A, 5 elements in set B. Okay. So now let's calculate how many 1-1 functions are possible. Again, let us start with the mappings possible for A1. A1 can have how many options? A1 can have how many options? 5 options, exactly. So this guy will have 5 options. A2, let's say A1 goes and maps to B3. Okay. A2 will have how many options now? 4, exactly. Only 4 options. So let's say this goes and maps to B1. Okay, see, I'm trying to generate a 1-1 function. So I'm trying my best only to create 1-1 functions. So I'm trying to see how many possibilities exist for me to create 1-1 functions. What about A3? A3, 3 options, exactly, absolutely. So this can go map to any one of B2, B4, and B5, the left outs, okay? So this generates a 1-1 function. So as per the given scenario, the total number of functions possible is 5 into 4 into 3, according to fundamental principle of multiplication. And this we normally call as 5P3. If you recall, when we were talking about permutation combinations, this is generally called as 5P3, isn't it? Other way around, Anusha. So the number of functions possible here, which are 1-1 in nature, will be RPN. Okay? RPN. Let me just remove this and write it down. Yeah. So you could actually club the second and the third case. Okay? So both these cases actually can be clubbed and you can write it like this. So number of 1-1 functions possible is 0 if R is less than N, and it is RPN if R is greater than or equal to N. This is to be noted and kept in mind because this is going to be a direct question for you in board exam also, or in JEE or other CET, Comet K, BIT exams also. This has been a very, you can say, regularly seen questions in competitive exams also. Is it fine? So let's do a quick exercise over here. Very small question I have for every one of you. So let us say there is a relation from set A to set B. There is a relation from set A to set B, where A has got 2 elements, B has got 4 elements. Okay. First of all, how many relations are possible? That's number one question. Then if let's say this relation happens to be a function also, how many functions are possible? Okay. And how many 1-1 functions are possible? Okay, let's answer these questions. Everybody, let me call this as 1, 2, and 3 so that you can number your answer as well. Quickly, I want everybody to respond. If they gave the range, if they give the range, then the range becomes your codomain. Okay, so codomain is something which is not a very mandatory field. Domain is more important, right? It's very important to know what you can input in a machine. What do you expect from the machine? That is not that important. So if somebody mentions you A and B, it is always considered as if he has mentioned domain and codomain. Even though B was a range, it will be called as a codomain. Okay. Aditya, does this answer your question? Clear? Okay. Yes. So number of relations, as most of you have rightly mentioned, is 2 to the power 8. Now 2 to the power 8 is almost 256. Okay. 256 relations are possible from set A to set B. Okay. How many functions are possible? The answer is 4 to the power 2, which is only 16. So what do you see here? You see that out of 256 relations possible, only 16 qualify to be called functions. Rest 240 are non-functional relations. Okay. See the ratio, very less. Getting the point? So number of functions is drastically less. How many of them are 1-1 functions? As you can see here, R is more than N. So it is 4P2. So 4P2 is 4 factorial by 2 factorial, which is nothing but 12. So out of 16, out of 16 functions, only 12 of them are 1-1. That means rest 4 of them are many one. Okay, we'll talk about many one separately. Exactly like JEE, yes. So out of so many people who write JEE, only few of you qualify. And out of few of you, only some, again selected few of you qualify JEE Advanced. So it's a rejection procedure. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions here? All right. Now a very vital question comes in your mind, that if somebody gives me a function, how do you identify it's a 1-1 function or not? So let me name the other concept as identification of 1-1 function. How does 1-1 identify? Sorry, how does one identify a 1-1 function? Okay, how does one identify a 1-1 function? So if I give you a function, okay, and of course I define the function, how will you be able to identify whether it's a 1-1 function or not? Okay. VIT, see, VIT exam is no different from your CT exam or other regional entrance exams. Okay. So if you do, see, don't focus on too many exams. There was some guy who said, sir, any special tip for VIT, any special tip for CET, any special tip for PSAT, any special tip for XYZ regional exam. See, only one tip is there. Prepare well for JEE Main. I'm not asking you to go for JEE Advanced. Prepare well for JEE Main. All your exams are going to be covered under that preparation. Yes. Testing may be different for these exams. Number of questions asked, the time duration, the negative marks involved, they will be different. But the idea, the concept remains the same for all these exams. Of course, JEE Advanced requires a bit of more training. You're some of the seniors who have scored 99.5 percentile and above, they are undergoing JEE Advanced training. So that is different. But if you are planning for any competitive level exam in India, your target should only be CET. Your target should only be JEE Main. No need to separately venture out for any other preparation. If you prepare separately for some exam, then what will happen? You will be useless for other, you know, deviations from that particular paper. For example, let's say I only prepared for CET where there was no negative mark. So I keep marking, even if I don't know how to solve it, I just take a guesswork also. If you do the same in JEE Main or BITSAT or exams which has got negative mark, you will end up, you know, making yourself rejected from the competition. So prepare for the most difficult part. You will automatically be well prepared for these exams. Is it fine? Akash, don't lower your guard. Okay, so JEE Main seems to be out of my this thing. JEE Main is not a difficult exam. It's an exam qualified by 2.5 lakh people. Even if you get 100 marks out of 300, you qualify JEE Main. Okay, so let's keep our ambitions at least to that part. Okay, now coming to the question, how do you identify a 1-1 function? So there are three ways to identify a 1-1 function. One is graphically. So I'll talk about graphical method first. So let us say you are aware of the graph of this. So this graph is known to you. Known to you, or you can draw it, or you can sketch it. Okay, so let's say it is a very sketchable function. You can easily sketch it by using your bridge course understandings of sketching a graph. So let's say you could sketch this graph. Then if you sketch this graph, then the process is just one simple test which we call as horizontal line test. Horizontal line test. What does this test say? This test says that if this function is a 1-1, so if f of x is a 1-1 function, then a horizontal line, okay, drawn to test the function, not to save the function. Are you getting my point? So when you're drawing a horizontal line, draw it in order to critique the function, okay, in order to test it, not to save it, okay. Then a horizontal line must cut the graph of f of x exactly at one point. Exactly at one point. Okay. Now, why is this test working? First of all, let us try to understand it. If you have a graph like this, let us say, okay, so let's say this graph is the graph of the function which you have been able to sketch. If I draw a horizontal line, okay, I can see that this line is only cutting the function at one point. So what does it indicate? It indicates that if there is an output B, it comes from a unique input A. But on the other hand, if I had a graph of a function like this, let me draw it in the same color as what I have drawn for the previous one. Yeah. So let's say there's a graph like this. Okay. And here if I draw a horizontal line, what is happening in this case? In this case, the horizontal line is going to cut the graph at multiple places. Okay, it is cutting here, it is cutting here, it is cutting here. What does it indicate? It indicates that a particular output, let's say B, is coming from multiple inputs, A1, A2, A3. Thereby suggesting that an image B doesn't have a unique pre-image. That means multiple inputs are giving you the same output. Correct? So in such cases, your function will no longer remain a 1-1. In fact, it is called many-1. And in this case, it will be a 1-1. Okay. So please read this test carefully. The test says that any horizontal line means line parallel to the x-axis. Okay. Now don't start drawing a line over here. Right? Don't like, sir, see if I draw it here, it is not cutting at all. No, you don't have to save the function. You have to, you know, test the function. Okay. So I can give you all easy questions and make you all get 300 out of 300 in JEE Main, but that is not testing you then. Getting the point? So in order to test you, I have to give you some questions which are challenging, which I feel you may not be able to solve. Okay. So any horizontal line drawn to test the function, if it cuts the function at exactly one point, then it's a 1-1 function, else it is a many-1 function. Okay. But this test is not to be used in school, because in school they do not honor this test, right? So in the school exam, please do not try to solve a question by sketching its graph and doing a horizontal line test on it. You may not be awarded marks for it. This may be used as a supplementary test, not as a primary test. Are you getting my point? So horizontal line test can be used in competitive exams, okay? Can be used in a regional entrance exam. But do not use it for school exams as a primary test. Use it as a supplementary test. Is it fine? Now this method has a drawback. The drawback is you should know how to sketch it, because many a times they may not give you the graph of the function. You may have to sketch it, and sometimes it becomes too challenging to sketch a graph of a function. Of course, if it is based on our basic transformations, we'll be able to do it. Like horizontal shifting or vertical shifting or mirror imaging, those are fine, but some graphs are beyond our scope to sketch it. Okay, so nevertheless, we have two more methods to take care of that. Meanwhile, any questions, any concerns with respect to what is a horizontal line test and why it is used? Is it clear to everybody? Clear? Everyone clear? Aditya, Gayatri, Havish, Anusha, Gaurav, Himanshu, Karthik, all clear? Everybody is fine, happy? Chalo. If you are happy, let's move on. So we'll move on to the second test, which is called the calculus test. Okay. Even though most of us are not very good in our calculus, but we will talk about it. Even though we'll be using it only when we learn our application of derivatives. Okay. So what is this test? Let us try to understand. Now, if I go back to the graphical test. Okay. Okay. So let me draw two cases for you. In fact, let me draw three cases for you. Let me draw three cases for you. Okay. So first is the case where a function is increasing like this. Okay. Do you think it is going to pass the horizontal line test? It's always increasing. Increasing means everybody understands, right? Increasing means if you put more input, output will also grow. That is called increasing function. Do you think it is going to pass HLT? Yes, sir. Everybody says, yes, sir. I also agree it is going to pass HLT. Okay. Let's say another example of a function always falls. Girta ja raha hai. Stock market ki tarah. I don't know how many of you follow stock market. So, yeah, it's falling down. That means if you put more input, output is going to fall down. Do you think it's going to pass HLT? It will pass. Yes. Very good. But if I take something like this, I think this is what I had drawn in the previous slide also. Do you think this is going to pass HLT? And here the function is exhibiting both type of nature. It is increasing also, decreasing also means in some interval of its domain, it is rising. In some interval of its domain, it is falling. Okay. So he will say this will pass HLT pass, but this fellow will be HLT fail. As if it is like matrix fail. Okay. This will fail the test, right? Now calculus tries to answer this in a very interesting way. It says that in the first two cases, if I pick any point on this curve and I sketch a tangent, the tangent at that point, let's say I take any point X, the slope of the tangent at any point X on this function will be given by f dash X. Just now we concluded our differentiation chapter. And in this case, you realize that any point if you take, the slope will always be positive. So slope will always be positive, correct? So in such situation, you'll see that your derivative of the function will always be positive for all X belonging to the domain of the function. Okay. So in situation number one, I'm just trying to fit in a bit of calculus. In situation number one, when your graph is always on the rise, the derivative of the function at every point on it, or at every point in the domain, will be positive. Agreed or not? Agreed or not? Okay, there's one exception. I will talk about it. Okay, little later on. In the second situation also, you would see that if I take any point, let's say X, and I draw a tangent at that point, the slope of the tangent here would be negative actually. Any point you take, let's say I take here also, okay, and I draw a tangent, its slope will be negative, right? I hope everybody knows derivative of a function at a point gives you the slope of the tangent drawn to the curve at that point, right? So in this case, you realize that the derivative of the function will always be negative for all x, this is the symbol for all x, belonging to the domain of the function, correct? Okay. Now these two cases are actually called monotonic functions. So these two are actually named as monotonic functions in the language of calculus. Monotonic functions, the word has come from the word monotonous, which means exhibiting the same type of nature always. So it is always rising. This guy is always falling. So there is a monotonicity in their behavior, isn't it? Just like most of our lives are, we are leading a very monotonous life. Morning, get up, attend the school. Evening, attend centum. Then in the night, we do some, you know, homework and we sleep off. It's a very monotonous lifestyle for us, isn't it? Okay. Yeah, of course. I understand in the 2 years of your life, you are going to have this kind of this is a disciplined life, I would say. So in these two functions, your functions are exhibiting monotonic nature. So monotonic functions are always known to be 1-1. That means either its derivative will always be positive or it will always be negative. It will not be like the third guy whose life is slightly different. That means sometimes it is having positive slope. And sometimes, And sometimes it is having a negative slope. Okay. So here it is having both positive and negative in the domain of the function. So whenever function is exhibiting non-monotonic nature, that means it is having positive as well as negative slope in the domain of the function, then those kind of functions are not going to be 1-1 in nature. Such functions normally exhibit a turning point in them. Turning point means they will have a point where this function will take a turn back. Okay, so this is basically called a turning point. You will come to know later on that this is called the local maxima and this is called the local minima. I would not go into the details of it because this is again a subject matter of maxima minima chapter coming up for you in application of derivatives. Some of you who may have started it in school would be aware of it. Okay. Now, while I was discussing the first two cases, I told you there are some exceptions. There could be equal to zero also sometimes in these two cases. Okay. Now be careful, equal to zero will also come here because here the slope will become zero, here also the slope will become zero. But these two equal to zero cases are different from the third one. Let me take an example to explain you. Let us consider a function x cube. X cube graph looks like this. Okay. Everybody knows x cube graph. This x cube graph is known to be a 1-1 function because if I draw any horizontal line, okay, it is going to cut it exactly at one point. Okay, so any horizontal line is going to cut exactly at one point, right? Now, if I try to solve this from calculus test, there is a point zero at which if I draw a tangent, let me draw it in green color, then this tangent will have a slope of zero. Okay. Then you may start, you know, contesting this rule that I gave you. You'll say, sir, you said it is always greater than zero. But here in this example, I could see even if it is equal to zero, it is still 1-1 function for us. So that is why to account for such cases, I slightly tweak my rule and include zero, but with a dotted line. Why with a dotted line? Because it depends upon the function. It depends on the function. Let me write on the function. Depends on the function. Why it depends on the function? Because if I give you a function like this, okay, let's say if I give you a function like this. Okay, let's say like this. Now here you would say, okay, let's say for the time being, you're trying to, you know, try to inquire the nature of this function. So here equal to zero is included because at this point the slope is becoming zero. In this case, it is exhibiting a turning point, whereas in this case it is exhibiting a point of inflection. Now turning point, point of inflection, etc. I don't want to go into details of it. I just want to understand it from a layman's point of view, that equal to zero is accepted if the function is basically taking a momentarily turn and going back in the same direction. Let me explain you in a very simple word. Let us say this is you. Okay. You are walking. Right. You are walking. Suddenly you stopped. Why would you have stopped? For two reasons. Either you want to take a turn back, correct? Or you are resting yourself and again you want to move ahead. Okay? Yes, you want to take a rest, you want to have an ice cream, and probably you want to move ahead, correct? So let's say your journey, your destination is not reached and you stop somewhere. It may be because of two reasons. You may want to rest yourself or you may want to go back. Well, you missed out something or you have, you know, forgotten your wallet or telephone at home, mobile phone at home, and you want to go back, right? So the same situation is happening with these two cases. Here this guy is stopping to take a rest and it is again moving in the same direction. So here the slope would be zero, but it would not be called as a turning point. It would be called as a point of inflection. So such cases, in such cases, you can claim these functions to be 1-1. But in the second case, which is happening here, the third one, or you can look at this diagram also, whatever, let's say this diagram. In this case, the guy is going to take a turn back. Right? So this is a turning point. This is not an inflection point. So whenever a turning point comes, any horizontal line will zoop, cut it at more than one point. Okay. So turning point is not allowed, but inflection point is allowed. That is why I have put this equal to zero with a dotted line over here, because I want you to use your discretion depending upon the function. Is it fine? So, summarizing this, what do I conclude? Let us summarize this. So now somebody is asking, sir, if I cannot draw the function, how do I know whether the function is momentarily stopping or it is, you know, basically, you know, taking a turn back? Now, for that you use your method of intervals. If you see here, Aditya, just to answer your question, Aditya, if you draw your wavy curve for f dash x, okay, and let's say you have a doubt on the point C, whether the point C is a point of inflection or a turning point, you would see that the sign scheme on the either side of the C will be either both positive or both negative. Okay, in such cases, C will be a point of inflection. Means it is taking a momentarily stop there. It is not going to take a turn. It is just stopping for rest. Okay. But if you realize that on making the wavy curve for f dash x, on the either side of C, there is a change in the sign. So whether from plus to minus or minus to plus, it means the curve is taking a turn back. So this is a turning point. Okay. Are you getting my point? Now, there are higher derivative tests also, but I don't want to go into that because many of you would say, sir, what if there are transcendental functions and I'm not able to make a wavy curve for it? What do I do in that case? Then there are some tests which is beyond your scope right now, but we'll definitely take them up in a matter of, let's say, 4 to 5 months when we start our application of derivatives. Not that late also, 3 months probably. Okay. So double derivative test, triple derivative test, all those tests are there. Okay. Don't worry too much about it. Let me tell you, Aditya, that the functions that will be given to you, they will be very simple for you to either analyze it by just doing the graph of f dash x equal to zero. Or there's one more test coming up that is even more better than this. But let me just summarize this. What is calculus test? What are we actually doing in a calculus test? In a calculus test, the summary is, you would be given a function. Okay. This function would be given to you. Okay. You find the derivative of this function and you realize that this function is always having a positive slope or always having a negative slope. Now this or is not inclusive or. This is exclusive or. Exclusive means dono nahi ho sakta saath mein. Ek hi hoga. Either it is always positive or always negative in your domain of the function. In your, or you can say for all x belonging to the domain of the function. If this is happening, then you can conclude that the function is a 1-1 function. Okay. Let me give you an example for it. Let's say I talk about x cube function in R to R. So let's say somebody gave me a function x cube. And he told me that, okay, do a calculus test on this to figure out whether this function is a 1-1 or not. So what I did first step, I just differentiated the function, correct? Now here, I realized that this is always greater than zero, but it could be equal to if your x is zero, right? Now here, I have to use my discretion. Whether that point was a point of inflection, zero was a point of inflection or zero was a turning point for me. Okay. So here it is very clear that it is always going to be greater than zero. Equal to zero can come in one occasion, which is 0 point, isn't it? So for that, I will make a wavy curve. We know that x square will show positive sign here also, positive sign here also. With special attention to Aditya, who asked this question. So Aditya here, it is a situation where you realize that your derivative of the function, if you draw the wavy curve for it, it is showing the same sign on either side of that number zero. C here in this case is zero. Then here you realize that this function, this point is actually a point of inflection. So inflection points are most welcome. So we will still call this function as a 1-1 function. Is this fine? Let me give you another example. Let's say I talk about x square function. And I say, figure out whether this is 1-1 function or not using calculus test. Then what will you do? You will differentiate this function. You will get a 2x. Now 2x can be positive also and negative also in real numbers, right? So if x is positive, your 2x will be positive. If your x is negative, your 2x will be negative. So basically it is exhibiting both the nature. So sometimes it is positive, sometimes it is negative. That is clearly the case because when you look at the graph, here it is positive, 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 positive. Here it is negative, negative, negative. So in this case, it is a many one function because it is not showing monotonic nature. Is that fine? Now again, this test is to be used only when you have done application of derivatives to a good extent, right? Don't start attempting questions unless until you are very sure about it, or unless until you have tried and tested your hand at finding the, in your application of derivatives concept. Okay, but ask your school teacher, she would be the right person to tell whether you can use calculus test for finding whether a function is 1-1 or not. If she says yes, you can do it, then go ahead, use it. Okay, so now we are moving on to the last test, which is the most commonly used test, and that is called the uniqueness test. Okay, so the third test which we are going to talk about, that is called the uniqueness. Okay, as the word itself says, there should be a uniqueness of the pre-image for every image. Okay, so what is this test? Let us try to understand this. And this is to be used in school exam. Okay, used for school exams. Now this test is very simple. It first starts with an assumption. Okay, it says that let there be two inputs, x1 and x2, coming from the domain of the function. Okay, coming from the domain of the function. In this case, the domain is your A. Okay, we all know this is your domain. Okay. So let's say there are two inputs. So what you do, you make an assumption in the beginning of the process that let's say there are two inputs, x1 and x2, which come from the domain of the function, such that these two inputs give you the same output. Are you getting my point? So what are you doing? You are basically having this assumption in your mind that let's say out of several inputs that I have, there are two inputs which actually end up giving me the same output. Okay, so output is your f of x1 or f of x2, since they are same, I'm equating it. Okay, so now using this assumption, if you simplify this equation of a bit more, and you end up getting x1 equal to x2 as the only possibility. Now this word only is very, very important. Then this function will be a 1-1 function. Now, why? Let me explain this. See, what are you doing here? You are, first of all, assuming that there are two separate inputs, x1 and x2, which are giving you the same output, correct? And later on, based on this assumption, you figure out that such a scenario will only exist if your inputs were equal, actually. That means you had uniqueness of the inputs. Are you getting my point? So unless until inputs are equal, output cannot be the same. That is what you are stumbling upon. That is what you are concluding with. Okay. So here, you start with the assumption that two different inputs, X1 and X2, that's why I have taken different names for them, have given me same output, and you later on realize that no, if that is happening, inputs also have to be the same. If that is happening, then your function is a 1-1. Okay. But why do I write only over here? Because common sense says that if ever you are asked to solve an equation like this, then x1 equal to x2 will always be the solution. Okay. Does it mean that every function in the world will become 1-1? No, right? Right? But if that is the only solution, that means there's no other possibility between x1 and x2. x1 equal to x2 is the only possibility, then that function is a 1-1. Let me illustrate this with a simple example. Let's say I take example one where I have a function x square again. Okay, so this is a very easy function to give as an example. So I'm taking that as an example. Okay, so here I'm taking x square as a function from defined from R to R. Okay, so I will say let x1 and x2 come from the domain of the function such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. So f of x1 means x1 square, f of x2 means x2 square. That means you're saying x1 square is equal to x2 square. Now for God's sake, for Jesus' sake, do not cancel out this, okay? These are the mistakes which a 10th grader makes when he's coming to 11th, not an 11th grader coming to 12th, okay? Because if you do that, you're going to miss out on the solutions, okay? Please do not do such mistakes of canceling out the powers on both the sides. So what are we going to do instead? We are going to take both of them to one side, okay? We are going to factorize them. Okay. And here we are seeing that we are left with two situations. One is x1 minus x2 is 0. And the other situation is x1 plus x2 is equal to 0. Okay. So this is not the only possibility. We have one more possibility, and that possibility is x1 is equal to negative x2. Right? And which is obvious also, right? So if you in an x square graph, the only way you can get the same output, let's say you want a 9 to come, then you can have the two inputs as 3, 3, or the two inputs as 3 and minus 3. That means negatives of each other. That is what this is trying to tell you. Okay, so these equations never lie. They will give you all possibilities. So either your two inputs are same, that means 3, 3 only has been put two times, then only you'll get a 9, or you put 3 and a minus 3, then only you'll get a 9. Okay. So what is happening in this case? This is not the only possibility. Unless until you are able to refute the second guy. You will not be able to refute the second guy because there may be two real numbers which are negative of each other, right? Okay. So here the conclusion will be this function is a many one function. It cannot be a 1-1 function because this is not the only possibility. However, that will always come out as a one of your answers, right? Because it is common sense. Huh? No matter whatever function you take on this world, if you say f of x1 equal to f of x2, x1 equal to x2 will always be a solution, isn't it? But you have to check, is that the only solution? If that is not the only solution, then it is many one. Got the point? Now, for the fun, I will take another example exactly of the same nature. This time my function will be defined from r plus 2r. Okay, the very same function x square. Okay, now see, how does it make a difference to your result? So again, we'll say let x1 and x2 belong to r plus, okay, such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. I think all the steps would be the same. So I will be just hurrying up in writing it. Okay. Let me put a dash. Tick, 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 tick. Yeah. Now here again, two possibilities come. X1 minus X2 is zero, or X1 plus X2 is zero. Okay. So that means X1 equal to X2 comes out, and the other one comes out to be X1 is equal to negative X2. Okay. But now here, try to understand, this is not possible. Why it is not possible? Think, why it is not possible? The answer is hidden in this step. Exactly, it has a positive domain. You cannot have one positive number negative of the other, right? Right? Ye ho hi nahi sakta. I cannot have a positive number equated to negative of another positive number, right? Isn't it? So what is happening in this case? In this case, the other condition or the other possibility is ruled out, or that is impossible. The other possibility is impossible. So that means it leaves this with the only possibility. Okay. In such case, your answer would be it's a 1-1 function. See, the very same function, I just change its domain and I made it from many 1 to 1-1. That is exactly what used to happen when you learned your inverse trig functions. Okay. All your trigonometric functions are known to be many 1. But do you remember we curtailed it in the principal value branch and we made them 1-1? Isn't it? Okay. So this is what I mean when I say only possibility. I'll take a pause here and I would request you to just give me a clear remark whether you have understood this, everybody. Then I'll move forward. Any element of doubt, any iota of doubt, you can please ping me over here. Okay. So before I move on, I would like to take a small break because it is a 2.5 hour session. We are already at 5:20. So we'll take a small break. Okay, 5-minute break, not more than that. So it's 5:18 p.m. now. 5:23 we'll resume again. Meanwhile, you can use this break time to grab a quick snack or have some water or use the washroom, whatever is your situation. Okay, we'll meet in 5 minutes time. Okay, so the first question that I would like you to solve, and this is a very funny and interesting question because it comes in school exam also. The question is, you already know the answer to it, but I would like you to solve it by your third method, which is your uniqueness test method. Is the function x cube defined from R to R a 1-1 function? I know you'll say yes, because you have already seen the graph of it before. But let's say, assuming that you're not aware of the graph of this function and you're trying to apply uniqueness test to figure out whether it's 1-1 or not, let's try to do this. Why I'm giving you this question is because this comes very, very frequently in school exams as well. Okay, and in school exams, as you know, they would not entertain your graph method. Okay, so everybody please do this and let me know. Just say done. Once you're done, let me know on the chat box. Very good, very good. Shitej, Anusha. Let me take the attendance also. So dear all, how are you finding a 2.5 hour session every day? Is it better than a 3.5 hour on one day? Or was the previous mode better? Honest opinion. This is better. Okay. Don't worry, we are anyways going to go back to the previous mode. was just trying to know your opinion. Okay, so 50-50 response. Some of you are saying this phone is better. You want 2.5 hours of classes? Only maths 4 times a week. So how many days are there in a week? So 4 into 3, 12 days should be there in a week, no? For you to have it. I understand, Akash. I can understand, Havish. Midnight classes. This definitely increases the number of contact hours, and hence we can cover more things. We can solve more questions, and then we can understand the topics in more detail. But once the school reopens, because some of the classes are also happening, your seniors have not passed out yet. So we are trying to accommodate them in the morning time. 3 times a day. Okay, we'll keep that in our consideration and we'll see what we can do. Okay, yes, so most of you are saying done. We'll wait for one more minute. Okay, Himanshu done, Pranav done. Pradyun, Rashmika, Atharv, Aditya Nair, done. Okay, Oshik, Aditi, Gaurav, where are you? Gaurav also done. Okay. Let's discuss this, guys. Again, if you want to use uniqueness test, let's say there are two such inputs belonging to the domain of the function, such that the output from the two is same. Okay. Now, it's very unfortunate that in one of these schools, I will not name it, the teacher actually cancelled out this powers. Okay, please, even if your teacher in school does it, avoid doing it. That is not a right way to look at things, right? So you cannot just cut off the powers like that. Okay, if that was so easy, that means math would become half as challenging as it is right now. Okay, so what is the best way to solve it? Of course, we have to take the x2 cube on the other side. We need to factorize it. Okay. Or like a good boy, I'm writing or so that you don't lose out any marks. So this implies either x1 minus x2 is equal to 0. That means x1 is equal to x2. Or you realize that this guy could be 0. Okay. So now two possibilities are arising. How do I show that the second possibility either will not exist or will point out to the first possibility only? So guys, we have to somehow convince the examiner that this is the only possibility. Other possibilities are actually not probable or not possible. Right? How do I do that? All of you, please pay attention. Most of you would have tried different ways to do it. But the best way to do it is write this term as x1 plus half x2, the whole square, plus 3 by 4 x2 square. Okay. Now see, if this is possible, then this is true. Correct? Because this expression is same as this. You can convince yourself. If you open the square, you'll have x1 square, x1 x2 plus 1/4 x2 square, and that 1/4 x2 square will combine with this to give you an x2 square. Okay, now see here, this term is greater than or equal to 0, this term is also greater than or equal to 0. So their sum will also be greater than or equal to 0. But if you want equal to 0, then only way is this should be 0 and this should be 0. There's no other way to get a 0 out of the sum of these two. If both are 0, means x2 is 0. And if x2 is 0, x1 square will be 0, which means x1 is 0. Correct? So unless until x1 and x2 both are 0 each, that means ultimately you are saying x1 equal to x2 again is the only output, is the only possibility coming. Right? So both these scenarios are reinforcing the fact or are supporting the cause that you can only have x1 equal to x2 as the possibility. This is the only possibility. Okay. So even though I got another one, or so as to say, prima facie, it looked out to be a different possibility. But we figured out slowly that even this guy points that x1 equal to x2. Of course, both should be zero, but still it is x1 equal to x2. Condition is being reinforced, isn't it? So this becomes the only possibility, and hence it is a 1-1 function. So what I want to highlight over here, don't easily give up. Right? Okay, I'm getting one more possibility, so yeah, 1-1 nahi hoga, it has to be one, many one. No, don't easily give up. Try to see whether the second possibility can be ruled out some way, or even that can be converted to x1 equal to x2 as the only case. Are you getting my point? See, what I did in the second part, Shreyas, I'll explain once again. Second possibility says, jab x1 square plus x1 x2 plus x2 square 0 hoga, tab bhi your output will be the same from both the inputs, right? So what I did is say, okay, if this is the case, that means this is the case. And if this is the case, that means this is the case. I hope the intermediate steps are clear to you what I did. So ultimately, what did you get? X1 and x2 are equal. Both are 0 means what? They're equal, no? At the end of the day, they're equal. So x1 equal to x2 is the only possibility. Correct? Some of you would have tried your this thing also, complex number approach. Many of you know that this could be factorized as x1 minus omega x2 and x1 minus omega square x2. And if this is 0, you're trying to say x1 by x2 is either omega or omega square. But x1 and x2 both are real numbers. How can ratio of two real numbers be basically a complex number? Yes, if they become 0, 0 each, it is a case of indeterminacy. In that case, your answer would be possible. Okay. So there's another way to justify it, but this is a better way, I would say. This is always a better way. I would say this way is a better way. Okay, better method. This will not raise eyebrows from your school teacher also. This probably my school teacher will say, yo, where omega, omega square and all is coming from this guy? Answer, okay. So avoid this, but this is for your understanding in an alternate way. Is it fine? Okay. So before I move on to questions, bit more of questions, I would just take the case of the complementary of 1-1, which is many one functions. Okay, and then we can take problems. So plain and simple, if anything is not 1-1, it is many one. It's the complementary breakup, right? Are you getting my point? If an integer is not even, it is odd. Simple as that. Okay, just like that, if a function is not 1-1, it is a many one. It cannot be both 50-50. It cannot be like it is 50-50, 1-1, 50-50, many one, no. So it is nothing but it is complementary of 1-1. So functions which are not 1-1 are many one. Okay. Formal definition here would be at least one image has a non-unique, or you can say multiple pre-images. Okay. So if you have at least one image which is having more than one pre-image, then that function will be called a many one function. So there is an existence of just one image which has got more than one pre-image. It will be called as a many one. Okay. Even one example, you are able to find out that a particular output is coming from more than one input which are not equal, then it is a many one function. Is it clear or not? Arrow diagram wise, I just give you a simple arrow diagram to just have a pictorial view in your mind. So this is a typical pictorial diagram of a function which is a many one. So let's say something like this. Okay. Okay. A constant function is a very good example for it. So let's say I talk about a constant function. So let's say a function which only gives you 3. Okay. So this is an example of a many one function, because no matter whatever input you have, let's say any real number you take, x1, x2, da 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 da, xn, all of them will point to the same fellow. Okay, so this is a typical example. Few more examples I can give, as I've been telling x square. Okay, but remember the domain will be all R. Okay, all your trig functions. Sine x function, cos x function, they're all many one functions, fine? So is there any separate test for a one function? The answer is no. The test for many one function is just the tests which are for one. See, is there any separate test for somebody who is corona negative? No, right? Same test is there. If the test comes out to be positive, you are having that virus. If the test comes out to be negative, you are not having that virus. Separate test to hota nahi uske liye, correct? So in the same way, if a function is not 1-1, that means if it fails, it should fail horizontal line test. Second, its derivative should be both positive and negative in the domain of the function. Okay. And if you do your uniqueness test, then this may imply x1 may not be equal to x2. Okay. Or x1, x2 may be distinct. Let me write it like this. x1 and x2 may be distinct. Okay. So whatever doesn't qualify to be 1-1 becomes a many one. So there's no separate test required for it. Okay, so that 1-1 test is only what we use. If it fails that test, we say it's many one. Is it fine? Any questions here? Similarly, if I talk about number of, let me go to the next slide. I hope you are done with the copying part of it. Such functions, normally they have a turning point in the graph of it. So whenever there's a many one function, they will always have a turning point in the graph. Done with this, can I move on to number of many one functions? Okay. So number of many one functions, again, an easy concept. Since we already know many one is complementary of 1-1, we can always find out the number of many one functions by deducting the number of 1-1 functions. So if your R happens to be less than N, please note that when this was a situation, there used to be no 1-1 functions possible, right? Right, I hope you recall that. When your number of elements in the codomain is lesser than the number of elements in the domain, there cannot be any 1-1 function, which means the total number of functions itself will be many one. That means all the functions will be many one in nature. So total number of functions is R to the power N, and subtract from it number of 1-1 functions, which is 0. So that leaves you with the answer as R to the power N only. That means if R is less than N, all functions that you can make will be many one in nature. Okay. If R is more than equal to N, then by using the same logic, total number of functions minus RPN. This will be your number of many one functions. Is this clear to everybody? Any questions, any concerns? Do let me know. Okay, now time to take some questions. Let us take some questions. No concerns, let's take some questions. So let's begin with some problem solving. I think we have discussed a lot of theory so far. Okay. We'll start with a very conceptual question. Which of the following statements are incorrect? Which of the following statements are incorrect? Now read the three statements carefully, very, very carefully. The first one says, if f and g are 1-1, then f plus g is also 1-1. Okay. Could you repeat the previous slide? I got disconnected. Maybe after this question, Anusha, can I take you to the next previous slide after this question? Okay. Second statement says, if f and g are 1-1, then f into g is also 1-1. Yes, in their common domain. Exactly, Pranav. So Pranav, remember, f plus g will exist in the overlap of the domain of f and g that you have already done in class 11. And the third statement says, if f is an odd function, then it is necessarily a 1-1 function. By the way, what's an odd function? Many of you would already be knowing about it, but those who are not aware about it, odd functions are those functions which satisfy this functional equation, f of minus x is negative of f of x. Exactly, Shitij. So I'll put the poll on. Please think and then respond. Don't be in a hurry to answer. I'll give you around 2.5 minutes for it. Time starts now. Today it drizzled a bit over here. What about your area? Did it drizzle a bit? Slight rain? Yeah, big relief. It was becoming hotter day by day. Oh, it rained heavily. Oh, in my area, it just drizzled. Okay, it'll rain very soon there, Shreyas. Fingers crossed. HSR ka kya scene hai, Gaurav? HSR, was it raining there? Anybody from HSR layout? Drizzle, okay. Last 30 seconds I can give you. Very few responses. Only 11 of you have responded. Come on, guys, everybody. Vaibhav, Rohit, Rashmika, Parvati, Omkar Vaidya, Lohit, Gurman, Charan Akash, Akash, Bhumika, number of O's are increasing every day in your name. By the time we end, Bhumika, Adit, Arabi. Okay, let's begin the countdown. I think most of you have responded. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so almost 91% of you have responded to it. Most of you say option number B, B for Bengaluru. However, there has been a close competition with option number D. 10 of you say option number D. Okay, let's check it out. Guys, all these questions you can actually refute by examples. Very simple example. Let's say for the first case, I take my f of x as x and g of x as a minus x. Okay, I could take minus x plus 2 also, not an issue. But the moment I add them, I get a 0, which happens to be a constant function. So this happens to be 1, 1, correct? Because if you draw the graph of y equal to x, you will never find it taking a turn anywhere. That means any horizontal line that you draw is going to cut the graph exactly at one point. Same is true for this guy as well, 1, 1. But the moment you add it, it's going to give you a constant function, which is unfortunately a many one. So whichever has, see, the question is which of the following are incorrect? Okay, so one is definitely incorrect. So whichever has one, they still stand a chance to be your right option. B doesn't have, so B will be ruled out. So people who said B, bye-bye. Most of you said B. B for bye-bye means your answer is wrong. Gone. Okay. Next. If f of x and g of x are 1-1, f of x into g of x will be 1-1. Now, same example. Same example. If I multiply f of x into g of x, I'll get negative x square. Negative x square graph, if you see, it is an inverted parabola like this. That means if I draw a horizontal line, it is going to cut it at more than one point. So definitely not 1-1. So option 2 is also an incorrect statement. So whichever doesn't have option 2, say bye-bye to that option, which is option C. Okay. So that leads to a close competition between A and D option. Okay. Next is, if f of x is an odd function, it is necessarily 1-1. Now we all know from our childhood that this is not correct because sine x function is clearly an odd function, correct? And this is not a 1-1 function because if I draw a horizontal line, it is going to cut at so many points, okay? So third statement is also incorrect. So whichever answer says 1, 2, and 3, that will be your right option. Option number D hence becomes right. So out of 31 of you who said, the 10 of you who said D, absolutely correct. Isn't sine x domain minus pi by 2 to, why sine x domain only minus pi by 2? It is kept as minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 to make it invertible. Here there is no question of making it invertible, Shritesh. Why are you unnecessarily restricting it to minus pi by 2 to pi by 2? We can use f of x equal to 0. Why not? In this case, your function. No, f of x equal to 0. F of x equal to 0 is a many one function. That is what I am trying to say. No. What is the question saying? It is necessarily a 1-1 function. So you are justifying what I am trying to say. The question is, if the function is odd. Now, 0 is both a 1-1 and, 0 is both even and odd. We'll come to see in the chapter when we are doing even-odd function. 0 is both 1-1 and, both even and odd. Okay, 0 is the only function which is both even and odd simultaneously. Yeah, you can use to disprove it. So, is it fine? Any questions here? Anybody? Let's move on to the next one. Okay. Now, this is a single option correct question. Which of the following? Oh, yes, Anusha. I'm so sorry. Anusha, I'll have to go to the previous slide. Just give me 1 second, guys and girls. Anusha wants to copy something. Nothing very serious here, Anusha. We just talked about number of many one functions possible. So these two, you can take either a snapshot. Okay, Pranav. What happened, Pranav? What happened to your computer? Shut down. What all you missed? I was about to say missed. What did you miss? Entire problem, huh? Ayyo. Okay, wait for the recordings to come to see it. Unfortunately, get a good computer, man. Yeah, don't worry, there is nothing very hard and fast. You can solve it. When you see the notes also, you can solve it. Okay, so let me put the poll on for this. Let's have around 3.5, 4 minutes max to solve this question. Not a difficult one, but still I'm giving you enough time to crack this. Which of the following is a one-one function? Single option, correct. Three minutes almost over. I can give you one more minute because I can see very few people have responded. Just eight of you have responded. So last minute, dear boys and girls, please buck up. Okay, the countdown begins now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Okay. I'm calling off the poll now. 26 of you have responded, out of which most of you have said option number C. Okay. Of course, few votes have gone to B as well. Let's try to check these functions in detail one by one. Okay. See, again, I will use a mixed approach. If I feel I can do it with graph, I'll do it by graph. If I feel I can do it by calculus test, I'll do it by calculus test. Okay. Now let's try to look into the very first function A. So A says you have a function from R to R defined as e to the power signum function. So this is a signum function. We all know the characteristic of a signum function. So signum function gives you a one. So let me just recall everybody what's a signum function. It gives you a one when x is positive, zero when x is zero, and minus one when x is negative, right? We all know the characteristic of a signum function, right? So in light of that, in light of this definition, I can redefine my function as, correct me if I'm wrong, e plus e to the power x square when x is positive. X is positive. Now since it is zero, I can put zero here also. So one plus one, which is a two. Okay. So two when x is two. X is zero. Okay. And e to the power minus one plus e to the power x square when x is negative. Correct. Now, if I sketch this graph, I think things will clear out very easily. First, let me talk about e to the power x square graph. Anybody knows e to the power x graph, or I can guess how would e to the power x square graph look like? First of all, e to the power x square graph, since there is an even power on x, it has to be symmetrical about y axis. Why is it symmetrical about y axis? Because if you change your x with a minus x, nothing will happen to the function. Correct? And normally when you write x as a minus x, the graph gets reflected about the y-axis. So something which is already symmetrical about y-axis, only that function will not get affected, right? So this graph, I predict that the graph will actually look like this. Okay. Any doubt regarding that? Okay. So let me show you on the GeoGebra also. It's very easy to guess this. Okay. So as I told you, there are some graphs which are very easy to, you know, sketch. So this is one of them. So I'll just show you e to the power x square graph. Khul jao, Simpson. Yes. Y is equal to e to the power x square. Yeah, there you go. Okay. So we're almost on the right. Okay, now let's go back. Let us try to sketch the graph of this function. So I'll again make my x and y axes, don't worry. So the first graph is plotted when x is more than zero and it is e plus e to the power x square. That means the same graph will get a kick up. That means this point, instead of being 0, 1, it will be 0, 1 plus e. Okay. So the same graph is getting a kick up by e. Okay. So here this point was 0, 1. Now it has gone up by e. Okay. Now put a hole over here. Why? Because 0 is not included here. It is only starting from right side of 0. From 0 plus. That is what we call it in the language of limits. Isn't it? Exactly at 0, it is at 2. So 2 will be somewhere over here. So 1 plus e is 3.7-ish. So almost half, you can say. Yeah, somewhere there. Roughly, you don't have to know exact position. Okay. And when x is less than 0, it is e to the power x square graph. That means look at the left arm of this graph. Just kick it up by 1 by e. 1 by e is 0.4-ish. Correct. So the graph will start from here. Okay. And will go up like this. Please note that this point will be 0, 1 by e plus 1. And don't forget to put a hole because, yeah, so there will be a hole over here. Now look at this graph and try to tell me, is this graph a 1-1 function or a many-1 function? The answer is loud and clear. If I draw a horizontal line like this, it is going to zoop, zoop. Cut it at two points. right? So it is clearly a many one. It is clearly a many one. Okay. Another way to look at it is, most people will say, sir, this is anyways a constant because it is either going to take E or a 1 or a 1 by E, right? So if you differentiate it, you are going to get the derivative of 1 plus something, which is 0 plus derivative of this guy is e to the power x square into 2x. Okay. Now it all depends on this x. If x is positive, everything is positive. If x is negative, everything is negative. So in your domain, it is going to show both the nature of positive and negative. So that is anyways non-monotonic. And if it is non-monotonic, it is many one. So this is not my answer. Okay. So people who said A, how many of you said A, by the way? Only two of you said A. Okay. So those two of you, sorry, my dears, A is not the correct answer. Now talking about B. B is an even a simpler case to deal with. Okay. If you see, I can guess two values for which I get the same output, and that is 1 and a minus 1. Correct? So if you see here, let's say I take 1, I'll get e to the power 2. If I take minus 1 also, I get e to the power 2. What does it mean? It means that there are two separate inputs for which the output is e square. So this is clearly a many one. Okay, aur kuch karne ka zarurat hi nahi hai. What I want to exhibit from this approach is that if you are able to figure out an example, or if an example strikes you that, okay, I can put a 1 and a minus 1, I can get the same output, then you can easily say it's a many one function. So one example is sufficient to disprove it. Calculus method for A you're talking about, Aditya? For the A option you're saying? A is very obvious, no? If you differentiate this guy, okay, it's going to give you e to the power x square into 2x. Correct? Right? So when x is positive, this will be positive if x is positive. And this will be negative if x is negative. And both belongs to your domain of the function. So it is showing both the characteristic. Both the characteristic it should not show. If you want it to be 1-1. It should show only one characteristic. Ya to badhta rahe, means always positive. Ya to girta rahe, always negative. It should not show both the nature. Got it, Aditya? Aditya, do you understand Hindi? Solpa, solpa, huh? Little bit, you understand? Little bit, okay. Panikkar, you are from Kerala, I believe, right? You're from Kerala, right? Originally, yeah. Okay. So your option number B is also gone for a toss. Let's see who all gave B. B, 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 B. Six of you said B. Sorry, my dears. Gone. Oh, Akash is also from Kerala. Okay. Coming to option number C. Let's check. See, again, read the function in light of the domain. Only from 3 to 4 you want to analyze this function. Are you getting my point? Never, never overlook the domain of the function. Again, I'm telling you, it is not important. It is absolutely mandatory for you to look at the domain. Okay. So when you talk about C, let me just copy this function. Okay. So when you talk about C option, your function was defined from 3 to 4. So let's redefine this function from 3 to 4. So your domain is from 3 to 4. And output is from, or codomain is from 4 to 6. So in 3 to 4, if you redefine the function, this guy will become x minus 1. This guy will become x minus 2. This guy will become x minus 3. But the last guy will become 4 minus x. Right? Remember how to redefine a function? We had already done this in our class 11. Okay? So mod x minus 1 is going to remain x minus 1 in that interval. Mod x minus 2 is going to remain x minus 2. Mod x minus 3 is going to remain x minus 3, but mod x minus 4 is going to become 4 minus x, isn't it? On simplification, if I'm not mistaken, this is going to cancel with this. It's going to give you 2x minus 2, which means it's a linear function. So if I sketch this graph, between 3 to 4, it is going to be a linear line like this. Okay, probably this end will be at 4, this end will be at 6. Okay, so this is your graph, and if I draw any horizontal line, it only cuts the graph at exactly one point. So this is 1, 1 for sure. So option number C is correct. That means your search ends over here, but we'll still solve the D part just to know what type of a function it was. Why 4 minus x? Hariharan, you're asking this question too late in your life. See, if I take any value between 3 and 4, let's say 3.2. Okay. What does mod of 3.2 minus 4 give you? You'll say, sir, it gives you 0.8. Correct? To get 0.8 from 3.2, you have to do 4 minus 3.2, right? So that's why 4 minus x. Is it fine, Hariharan? Clear? So yeah, Hariharan, just revisit your modulus part of class 11th, how to redefine the function. It'll be very clear to you. Or you can watch my bridge course notes or lectures on your Learnist. Okay, coming back to your D part. Under root of ln cos of sine x. Okay, let's talk about D. Since nothing is mentioned about the domain, etc., we'll take the most exhaustive domain possible. What was it? By the way, I forgot. Ln cos sine x. Ln cos sine x. Okay, now everybody please understand here. See, since there is an outside root, and you want this to be a real valued function, then this guy must be greater than or equal to 0. Agreed? Because there is an outside square root over it. Yes or no? Yes or no? That means you're saying cos of sine x is greater than or equal to 1. I hope you remember your logarithmic inequations that we did under the chapter theory of equation last year. Correct? But we know that cos sine x, cos of anything cannot exceed 1, right? So this implies cos of sine x can only be equal to 1, because this is out of question. Agreed? So far, fine with everybody? So far, fine with everybody? Okay. All right. Now, this means sine x has to be only 0. But here, many people will say, sir, why 0? Why not 2 pi? Why not minus 2 pi? Why not 4 pi? Why not minus 4 pi? For the simple reason, it cannot be 2 pi, because 2 pi is roughly 6.28. Sine cannot become 6.28, right? साइन की एक मर्यादा है, माइनस वन टू वन, उस मर्यादा का उल्लंघन नहीं कर सकता वो, राइट? इट हैज अ लिमिटेशन, सॉरी आई स्पोक टू मच हिंदी, इट हैज अ लिमिटेशन टू बी बिटवीन माइनस वन टू वन, इट कैन नॉट सरपास दैट, इट कैन नॉट सरपास दीज वैल्यूज ऑल्सो, सो इट ओनली कैन बिकम अ जीरो, एंड इफ साइन एक्स इज जीरो, योर एक्स कैन ओनली बी मल्टीपल्स ऑफ पाई, करेक्ट? So it can be 0, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi, minus pi, minus 2 pi, minus 3 pi, and so on and so forth. Now, what do I understand from this entire set of process which I did? I realized that this function will only exist for such values of inputs which are multiples of pi. And if you put any multiple of pi, sine x is going to become a 0. Cos x is going to become a 1, ln is going to become a 0. That means your output will always be a anda, will always be a 0. What kind of a function is this? What kind of a function is this? It's a constant function. A constant function is a many one function. We all know that. So the verdict, the final judgment is many one function. So this guy is also not correct. Just for fun, we solved it. We could have stopped at C also, but I wanted you to have a complete picture of the scenario. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. So we'll now move on to another typification of functions. So what we did was one type of typification. What was that type? 1, 1, many one. Okay. This is another typification which is called onto into. नाम तो सुना ही होगा, करेक्ट? यू मस्ट हैव हर्ड ऑफ दिस ऑनटू और रेड ऑफ दिस ऑनटू मेनी प्लेसेस व्हाइल सॉल्विंग द प्रॉब्लम्स, राइट? So onto functions, what is onto functions? First of all, I'll tell you the name, alternate name for it. It is also called surjective functions. Okay. This name surjective, I mean, many people ask me, sir, what does it mean? Okay. It was actually, it's given by a French guy called Nicolas Bourbaki. So it was given by a French guy, by a French mathematician called Nicolas Bourbaki. Okay, he used this word surjective while talking about these kind of functions. What are these functions? We'll discuss. But there is no, I mean, I at least I do not know of any meaning of the word surject. Okay, if you're able to find a meaning to it, do let me know. I just know that this guy, French guy, he was a French mathematician. He came up with this word surjective, and that's why it is called surjective. You may also call it a surjection. Again, a mixture of the word surject and ion, surjection. Okay. What is the onto function or what is the surjective function? In plain simple words, functions where your codomain is equal to the range. That is to say, every element of the codomain must have at least one pre-image. Must have at least one pre-image. That means there cannot be any element of the codomain which is left unmapped. Plain and simple. So all the elements of your codomain must enter into the mapping or must have at least one pre-image that gives that answer. Are you getting my point? So normally we know that your range is a subset of the codomain, right? So if that subset is an improper subset, it becomes an onto function. Okay. If it is a proper subset, it will become an into function. I'll talk about it in some time. Okay. So is it clear what's a onto function? Where every element of the codomain, I'm not saying every image. I'm saying every element of the codomain must have at least one pre-image. Okay. A typical arrow diagram, if I have to draw for the same, just a typical arrow diagram so that there is a image left in your mind. So let's say A1, A2, A3, A4, and let's say this is B1, B2, B3. So basically, something like this is a onto function. You can see that none of the elements of set V, which happens to be your codomain, is left out. By the way, if I ask you a complete name for this function, you will say many one onto function. Yes. So we'll have a permutation combination of these two typifications. It is not like it is either only one one or only many one or only onto or only into. There can be a combination also. So this is an example of a many one onto. Okay. So from one one and many one, you can pick one of them. And from onto and into, you can pick one of them and you can combine it to create another type of function. So it could be like one one onto, one one into, many one onto, many one into. So four combinations can result from it. But it cannot be one one many one simultaneously. Okay. Don't say, sir, it is a one one many one function. No, that cannot happen because they are complementary. But one one can pair up with either onto into. Many one can pair up with onto into. Similarly, onto into cannot go together. They are complementary. What is into? I will discuss with you in some time. Now, what is the method to find? What is the test to find or identify? I should use the word identify, not find. Test to identify an onto function. Okay. The test is simple. Find the range. So let's say there's a function given to you. So find the range of F. How will you find out? You already know the trick. You have done it in class 11th. Correct? सर भूल गए वो तो कब का किया था सर, वी डोंट रिमेम्बर नाउ सर, देन प्लीज गो एंड रिवाइज. सिंपल, ओपन योर आदि शर्मा बुक, सॉल्व फ्यू क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम द एमसीक्यूज, ओके, ऑफ टू हाउ टू फाइंड आउट द रेंज, बिकॉज दैट इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी टॉट. ऑफकोर्स वी आर गोइंग टू डू एग्जाम्पल्स एंड इन दैट प्रोसेस वी आर गोइंग टू रिकॉल इट. एंड इफ योर रेंज हैपन्स टू बी, सो दिस इज स्टेप नंबर वन, एंड इफ योर रेंज हैपन्स टू बी इक्वल टू सेट बी, then this implies it's a onto function. Okay? Else it will be into function. Okay, we'll talk about into in some time. So is this test clear? Is this test clear to you? Any questions? So what's an onto function in plain and simple word? Where codomain is equal to the range. Correct? What is the test to figure out whether a function is onto or not? Find out the range by whatever process you know. See whether it is equal to your set B given in the question. So B will be given to you in the question. Okay, so this will be given you. This will be given to you in the question. Right? Check whether they are equal. If they are equal, it's onto. If they are not, it's into. Simple as that. Okay. So since I talked about onto, I'll also talk about into. Into is just a complementary of onto. So what's an into function? Plain and simple words, it's complementary to onto. Okay. That means at least one element of set B must not have any pre-image. Okay, so if there is an element of set B which is left out, let me give you a diagrammatic representation of it so that the picture is well set in your mind. So something like this is an into function. So let's say this goes to B1, this goes to B2, this goes to B4. So what is happening? B3 is left out, is left unmapped, correct? So at least one element of B doesn't have any pre-image. That means it is not an image for that matter. That means in this case, your range happens to be a proper subset of your codomain, okay? So in such cases, your function will be a into function. So this is an example of an into function, or you can say non-surjective function. Okay. Is it clear? Now, one exercise that we did for the previous cases was how many number of onto into functions. So let us talk about that as well. Meanwhile, if you want to copy something, please do that. Done. So everybody is now clear with what's codomain and range, they are same. Okay. And in into, range is a proper subset of the codomain. Okay. Now, coming to the next part, how many onto functions are there? So number of onto functions. Now here, let me first ask this question to you. Very simple question. How many onto functions are possible if, let's say, the number of elements in set A is N, number of elements in set B is R. How many onto functions are possible if N happens to be lesser than R? Think carefully and answer. How many onto functions are possible if N happens to be lesser than R? Please give me a response on the chat box. Excellent, excellent, excellent. Okay. Okay. Most of you have given the right answer. The answer here is zero. Okay, now see how. See, when n happens to be less than r, okay, so let's say I take a case study. I take a case study where this is 3 and this is 4. Okay. So let us say, there are 3 elements A1, A2, A3 in A, and there are 4 elements B1, B2, B3, and B4 in B. Okay. Now my attempt would be to make an onto function. That means I would not like to miss out on any one of B1, B2, B3. Okay. So let's start the mapping. And again, I'm starting with the, an attempt to create an onto function. Okay. So let's say A1 goes and maps to B1. Correct. Now, if I want to create onto function, I would like as much as B1, B2, B3, B4 to get mapped, right? So I would not like A2 to map to B1 again. So I'll choose a different, element to map. But however hard I try, I would realize that B4 is left out. Now you'll say, sir, map A3 to B4. But this is not a function, right? I cannot map A3 to B4 because it will violate the definition of a function. In function, any pre-image cannot have multiple images, isn't it? So whatever I do, one of them here will be left out. Correct? That means there will be no onto function possible. This will actually become into. So the answer here is zero. Now this situation you can think as if there are, so this situation is analogous to saying that you have to distribute n different balls or n different objects to r people or r persons such that every person gets at least one object. Okay, so finding the number of onto function is like meeting this criteria where you are trying to distribute n objects which are distinct among r people such that every person gets an object, at least one object he should get. So what is happening when n is less than r? So number of objects are less, number of people are more, then how can you ensure that every person gets at least one object? You cannot ensure. There will be one person at least who will go empty-handed. Okay, that is exactly happening in this case also. Okay, so here you cannot have any onto functions made. Now, tell me what will happen if n is equal to r. What is your result? Some people are already ready with the answer, r factorial or n factorial, absolutely correct. Okay, very obvious if you take n as r, so let's say I take n is equal to r scenario. Let's say I take both of them as 3, 3, just for figuring it out. Let's figure it out. So let's say I have 3, 3 elements in each one of them, A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3. Now, if you want to create an onto function, you must try to use single mapping as far as possible. So this maps to this, let's say. This maps to this, let's say. And this maps to this. Correct? In this case, you will realize that you will automatically end up having 1-1 mapping. Because if you do many one mapping, there is a chance that an element of set B will be left out. Isn't it? So let us say I decide to not map A3 to B3. I decided to map to B2. Right? So what will happen? This guy will be crying. It is left. Nobody is attending to it. Okay. So this will no longer remain a onto function. So when R is equal to N, it tantamounts to you having a 1-1 function. Correct? So how many 1-1 functions were possible? When we talked about n and r being equal, it was clearly n factorial or r factorial. So this becomes your total number of onto functions. Okay. Now, guys and girls, the third case where n happens to be more than r. This is tricky, actually. This is tricky. Some people are saying r to the power n, but this is tricky, actually. Okay. And that's why I decided I will discuss it in the next class with you, because it requires around 20 minutes, at least 15 minutes of discussion, which we actually don't have. So this is something which is slightly tricky. Okay. Why it is tricky? And those who are giving the answers that you feel, please try it out with some small example. Okay, it will not work. No, it is not zero. It is going to be a formula which comes from principle of inclusion and exclusion. We'll talk about it in our Friday's class. Don't worry. So Friday's class will start with this. But before we end today's session, a lot of things changes. Aditya will discuss in our next class. Okay. Don't worry about it. But I would like to summarize today's class with one question on identification, or one question on onto function, because I don't want to end the class without it, else you will not be able to solve your DPPs. So just one question I will take up on this. Okay. So that later part, we'll discuss it in our next class. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Let's focus on this question for the next 3 minutes that are left. There's a function defined from R to A as x square by x square plus 1. If this function is a surjection, find your set A, or what is the most exhaustive set A possible. Let's solve this. I'll give you around 2 minutes. Yeah, YPR, your teacher will start integration. I don't know why. Very good, Pranav. Guys, let me tell you, integration is a chapter which is not 1 week, not 2 week, not 3 week. It takes around 1.5 months to finish. It's huge. The chapter is huge because you have almost 20 to 25 types of integration. Yeah, you have a lot of types of integration, and for every type, you need to at least practice 5 to 6 problems. Okay, so many people are saying, okay. I would love everybody to respond. This is our last question for the day. So please participate. Okay, Himanshu, Lohit, Aditya, Oshik, who else? Pranav, Pratik. Okay, so what is a set A? Set A is the range, isn't it? So basically you have to find out the range of this guy. Okay, so let's figure out what is the range. Even if you have not done it earlier, we'll discuss it out. So range में हम लोग क्या करते हैं? We first equate it to y, okay, and then we make x the subject of the formula. So here, if you want to make x the subject of the formula, let's cross multiply, okay. So this boils down to x square minus 1y, or you can write it like this. x square y minus 1 plus y equal to 0. Okay. So this gives you x square as y by 1 minus y. Correct? Yes or no? Okay. So x being a real number, x square will always be greater than equal to 0. That means y by 1 minus y should always be greater than equal to 0. This thing can easily be done by our wavy curve, or what we call as method of intervals. Okay, so let's plot down the zeros of this. So zeros of this is 0 and 1. This side will be negative, my dear. Please be careful. Don't be like blindly putting positive sign to the rightmost interval. You can always do a sample check. For example, if I pick up a 2 and I put over here, I'll always get a negative answer, 2 by 1 minus 2. Correct? So this is negative. So this will become positive because all these factors are subjected to odd powers. Okay, and again, this will be negative. So there will be a switching of the signs. Again, people who were not with us in the last year when we did this wavy curve, I would request you to watch the lecture on theory of equations. Okay, if you cannot find it on Learnist, you can always ping me. I will send you the entire video series for that. Okay, now here you want it to be greater than or equal to 0. So please note that between 0 to 1, but 1 cannot be included, 0 can be included. So this will become your range, and hence this will become your set A. So those who have answered with 0 to 1, 0 inclusive, 1 exclusive, thumbs up, absolutely correct. Okay. So dear all, we have just started with this concept. We are going to take many more examples in the coming class. In the Friday's class, we will, first of all, we'll do how many onto functions are there. And then we'll also talk about how many into functions. And then we'll take a mix of all the types. Okay, as I told you, there can be permutation combinations. So we'll talk about mix of both the types. Meanwhile, today I'll also send you the DPPs. Try to submit it. Okay, let's try to submit it next Wednesday. Okay, I'll give you 1 week time to submit it. And next class, we are also going to talk about more concepts like composition of functions and all. Now, you may hear of some word called bijective in your DPP. So I'll just talk about it for 1 minute. I hope I'm not taking much of your time. You will come across a word called bijective many a times in DPP. Bijective functions are basically those functions which are both 1-1 and onto. Okay, so a combination of injective plus surjective becomes bijective. Okay, so 1-1 and onto functions, they are called to be, bijective functions. Bijections also is correct. Okay, they are called to be bijective functions. We will discuss about it a little later on in our next class, which is on Friday. Okay, so this will be continued. Thanks so much for joining in for today's class. Thank you so much. Thank you, Gaurav. Hariharan, bye-bye. Take care.